3 weeks, and this is Bounce. On this podcast, we talk with people from a variety of fields about dealing with challenges and adversity and how they bounce back or push through. To that end, this will be an interview format. In each episode, we're going to have conversations about setback, whether it's career or business. It could be physical or psychological pain. We're going to try to parse out how our guests dealt with it or deal with it, as the case may be, and how we can learn from it. Welcome to Bounce.
Traditionally, the bigger you were, the safer you were, because size conferred a certain advantage. But what we discovered in that last decade was it didn't matter how big you were. There's some storms you just can't run from. In an environment of lots of volatility, it's hard to plan. So it's hard to look out and say, I know where things are going to be in 5 years. So there's a kind of reaction that we encounter in which we have to focus on being resilient. Some stress and some adversity teaches us how to be resilient up to a point where the returns begin to diminish and where increasing additional amounts of adversity and failure actually just set us back permanently and we're not able to recover.
Welcome to another episode of the Bounce Podcast, where we talk with people from a wide variety of fields. We'll talk with authors, entrepreneurs, doctors, journalists, and many others to get their stories or research on how to deal with or prepare for life's challenges, setbacks, aches and pains, or its stumbles. We'll find out what they've learned and see if we can apply it to our lives. My guest today on the podcast is Andrew Zolli. He is the author of the best-selling book, Resilience, Why Things Bounce Back. It's published by Simon and Schuster in the U.S. and many other languages and territories around the world. The book is his research on the dynamics of resilience in many contexts, whether it be people, systems, communities, or companies. And it answers the question, in times of upheaval, why do communities, companies, people, and systems thrive or while others fall apart? And on this podcast, we have a very interesting discussion, and we talk about what his research on resilience, what it is, how it's expressed in actual living things and dynamic systems, why organizations, systems, and people bounce or not. And we talk about social media and social media platforms in regards to resilience. Are they making us weaker or stronger? We talk about the impact of faith on resilience, and it's not what you think. We have an interesting discussion on what he learned about organizational resilience in New Orleans after Hurricane Katrina, and so much more. I really enjoyed our discussion and think you will too. I would love to follow Andrew around for a few days and just listen as he is involved in a lot of very, very interesting companies and projects. For 11 years, he was the primary creative force behind PopTech. It's a renowned innovation and social change network. The organization brings together a community of innovators from a variety of fields like artists, scientists, technologists, social change agents, entrepreneurs, to share ideas and to work on new approaches to some of the world's toughest problems. He served on the boards of the Brooklyn Academy of Music, the Garrison Institute, which is an organization that explores the intersection of contemplative practice and engaged action in the world. He served on the boards of Blurb. It's a breakthrough personal publishing platform. He also serves as an advisor to Planet Labs, which is a very interesting company that has a revolutionary earth imaging technology. Datakind, which is bringing data science to the social sector. And the Workshop School. It's a transformational experiment in what a public high school can be, taking place in Philadelphia, among many others. He's also been honored to serve as a fellow of the National Geographic Society. He strategically advises and speaks regularly to a wide array of leading companies, governmental organizations, startups, cultural and civil society groups. He's advised senior leadership teams at companies including Facebook, Nike, GE, and many others. Like I said, I really enjoyed talking with Andrew. I think you will too, so enjoy the show. Andrew, welcome to the show.
It's great to be here. Thanks for having me.
How'd I do? Did I get everything right?
You got everything right, except that I'm no longer with PopTech.
So you have this variety, Andrew, of knowledge and experiences from technology to contemplative practices and what have you. Tell me, how did you come to write this book on resilience?
Let me say to you that I was very honored, as I mentioned a few minutes ago, to spend time cultivating this network of scientists and social innovators and governmental leaders and corporate leaders. And something very interesting happened in the middle of the last decade. But in order to explain it, I want to actually talk about the decade that came before. I'm of the opinion that much of our outlook on life is shaped by the first decade that we spend as an adult, the first decade we really own start to finish. And for me, that decade was the 90s. Now, the 90s was an amazing period. That was Web 1.0. And if you can remember the kind of, pre-millennial triumphalism of our society, you know, we had the internet was ascendant, the Soviet Union was in retreat. America could begin to pare back its military footprint and spend its peace dividend. And really, it was a go-go time in American history. And people were writing books at that time with titles like The End of History. We'd come to the terminal point at which the major ideological conflict between capitalism and communism was resolved. It was resolved in favor of the American system, and it was just going to be peaches and gravy from here on out. Now, contrast that with the decade that literally followed that one. I mean, starting in 2001 and ending in 2010, you had a decade defined by two crises in the same zip code, 9/11 and at the beginning of the decade, and the financial crisis at the end of the decade. One, a shock driven from without, from far beyond its borders, and one driven by a shock created within by the people who were its stewards. And in between, we had Katrina, Iraq, Afghanistan. We had just demonstration after demonstration that the volatility and disruptive nature of the world was sufficient to swamp every institution. Traditionally, the bigger you were, the safer you were, because size conferred a certain advantage. But what we discovered in that last decade was it didn't matter how big you were. There's some storms you just can't run from. And by the middle of that period, by about 2005, you could see among social scientists and technologists and corporate leaders and governmental leaders and on, you could see people beginning to wrestle with this question of how do we survive? How do we recover and thrive in this period of sustained volatility? And I think in some ways, you can look at the recent election as a kind of vote for someone who says, I can turn us to a place of strength. People who've experienced a sustained, our society has experienced a lot of sustained shocks. And it's not surprising that the person who says, I will put us first, I will wall us off, and I will protect us from the vicissitudes of the, you know, that are shaking the larger system, that message would resonate right now.
You're saying part of it was a show of strength, or is it, in your opinion, more leadership or a security?
Yeah, I think that's right. I think you're exactly right. People are feeling fragile after a decade. I mean, if you think about,
they've been beat up,
yeah. Right? Our confidence in institutions is at an all-time low. Our belief that the normal things that protect us from volatility and disruption, the kind of the safety of institutions has been challenged. And so there's a lot of fear in our society. And as a consequence, when you find yourself in an ambiguous place, when you find yourself in a frightening place, you can either press forward to the new place, or you can say, I'm in a ditch, I have to back myself out and go back to something I understand. Either of those are rational responses mm-hmm. to being in that circumstance. Mm-hmm. And the contests we're having in our society at the moment are really a byproduct of people who line up on one side of the answer or the other to what to do in this period. So the essential underlying truth is the volatility of these systems, the ecological volatility that we've experienced with climate effects around the world, is nothing compared to what we're going to experience. The political and social and technological upheaval that we've experienced in the last few decades, and in the last decade in particular, is nothing compared to the kinds of technological upheavals that are coming. So we're in this odd position where downside risks, the challenges that we confront, are bigger than the normal scope of our cognition. They're hard to wrap our heads around. But it's also true that the upside opportunities, the great advantages that technologies in particular might convey upon the world to help us lead more sustainable and less dreary lives, are also hard to wrap our heads around. You know, we're in a moment when the scope and scale of our challenges is bigger than our normal rate of cognition, and this scope and scale and growth of our capabilities is moving faster than our ability to think.
So this kind of informed your overall consciousness when you wrote the book. You said
that's right. Yeah. So it became clear in an environment like that. First of all, in an environment of lots of volatility, it's hard to plan. So it's hard to look out and say, I know where things are going to be in 5 years. So there's a kind of, instead, there's a reaction that we encounter in which we have to focus on being resilient. In an era of what will certainly be inevitable surprise and continuous surprise, we really have to design systems and habits and practices that help us persist, recover, or even thrive amid disruption. And that's how I define resilience, the ability to persist, recover, or thrive amid continuous disruption.
So when it comes to resilience, are failures, disruptions, as you state them, or setbacks, are they necessary experiences for resilience or developing resilience?
Well, the answer is qualified partly is the answer. So it's a really interesting question. Let's take it out of the realm of systems and put it in the scope of everyday life. It's a really interesting question. What is the effect of major adversity, major failures, and the experience of extremely traumatic events on our resilience? And the relationship between our resilience and the degree of adversity we've encountered follows an inverted U-shape. And this is going to take a second to explain. So there are a number of researchers, including Mark Seary at the University of Buffalo, has done this series of studies in which they look at people who self-report across a spectrum of having experienced relatively little adversity to increasingly significant amounts of adversity to a lot. And what Seary and many other serious studies and many of his colleagues' studies have borne out is that the relationship between stress and adversity and failures and setbacks and resilience is that if you have some of them, they actually improve your resilience, because stress teaches you how to deal with stress. adversity teaches you how to deal with adversity. It's called the stress inoculation effect. So people who have who've been largely sheltered from life, from the vicissitudes of life, are fairly irresilient. They're fairly fragile. If you're leading the Kardashian lifestyle and your biggest problem is what brand of caviar to put on your cornflakes every morning, you are irresilient in some of the same ways that people who have experienced huge amounts of adversity are irresilient. And there's a kind of warm zone in the middle. So some stress and some adversity teaches us how to be resilient up to a point where the returns begin to diminish and where increasing additional amounts of adversity and failure actually just set us back permanently and we're not able to recover. Does that make sense?
It makes total sense. Where there's a breaking point is a poor phrase for it, but there is this sweet spot or Goldilocks area where you become very resilient. That's got to be different for everybody, that spot, right? You're saying that in some cases, and don't let me put words in your mouth, but in some cases, too much stress or disruption or whatever it is will put you in the spot where you cannot... you will be in a similar place as if you had never encountered it and were not prepared.
That's right. So if you can imagine in this spectra, there are people who frankly aren't stressed enough by life. They don't encounter meaningful challenges.
And they don't grow.
And they don't grow as a consequence.
What have you.
Exactly. Right. And they don't, you know, the adversity is a teacher. Or at least it certainly can be. And this is why people who often live in sheltered environments, it's why things like Outward Bound is so effective for many people. People will literally give themselves artificial challenges, but meaningful challenges to overcome is a way of getting the learning benefit from adversity. At the other end of the spectrum, there is a threshold beyond which adversity continues to be a teacher. And at that point, it simply knocks you down. And you can see that in particular in certain communities that we have effectively sorted out and abandoned across America, where you have not just individual trauma, but the intergenerational transmission of trauma, because people are so pummeled that they're not able to come back to equilibrium and reintegrate before the next major trauma hits. And there's certainly a point where adversity always contains some lessons. It's really like this. I drop a pebble on your head. You've never had a pebble dropped on your head. It bounces off your forehead and you say, ow. I drop another one on your head and you say, ow. And at a certain point, you step out of the way of the pebbles, right? You learn to avoid the modest, non-threatening, non-endangering, little experiment that I'm running, you know, irritating you with my dropping pebbles. Now, at the other end of the spectrum, so you respond to it, and you respond to it in a way in which you might, in this instance, start to look around, look for the source of the pebbles, step out of the way of them, and engage in some harm avoidance behavior. You're showing resilience, the ability to contend with, in this case, something negative. It's not terribly consequential, but your responsiveness is part of your resilience. At the other end of the spectrum, we've got another person, a clone of you, and on that, Larry, we're dropping boulders, and we're dropping them every, you know, 5 minutes, right, or every 5 seconds. And at a certain point, they're so big and they're coming at such a speed that this version of Larry can't get out of the way of them. Now, at that point, the learning, the ability to deduce what's happening, move out of the way, take compensatory action, and come back to equilibrium, doesn't occur because, you know, you're trapped under the first rock, and then the second rock lands on top of the first, and the third lands on top of the second, and so forth. So the important thing is that there is a point where the returns from adversity diminish to near zero. You know, they're you're not getting a lot of value. You're just being beat up. And there are always exceptions. There are always people who manage in sometimes very surprising ways, come back from what seem like profound shocks and disruptions, and a lot of them. By and large, people exist within the realm of these two goalposts, right? Yeah. For much of their life.
Are there some people, do you think, that will never tap into their deepest strengths unless they're forced to do so by some kind of adversity?
Okay. Absolutely. Yeah. I guess what I would say about that is that human resilience is a widespread phenomenon, and it's a surprising phenomenon. In children, it's so widespread that one of the leading thinkers about it, a child psychologist named Ann Mastin at the University of Minnesota, actually has a term for it. She calls it ordinary magic. It seems magical that human beings could contend with some of the things that they contend with. And we can get into what encourages resilience. And there are many factors that encourage our resilience. So there will always be extraordinary stories of human resilience amid very severe adversity. I guess the point I'm trying to suggest is that for most of us, resilience is a skill we can cultivate. There is a point where where we just all move ultimately past some end threshold beyond which we can't be resilient anymore. That end threshold exists. It's often surprisingly far out for most people, and many people are themselves surprised by what they're able to contend with and to recover from.
Yeah. What's so interesting about your book to me was just, I never thought about resilience in terms of a country or a organization or, mm-hmm. Systems. And I think you do talk about some businesses that were very resilient going through catastrophe. I think it was it may have been Katrina, but I thought, wow, I never looked at my management style or, the work environment I'm in from a standpoint of preparation. And, we're dealing with such mundane things. But anyway, it was very fascinating. It amazes me after 9/11, I always reflect, what a horror it was, but how that the country came back from it. Mm-hmm. It still amazes me. I'm like, how did we ever get over that? Andrew, I thought, at the time, I'm like, there's no way we're getting over this. This will, mm-hmm. We'll always be looking over our shoulder and all, but life goes on. It seems like sometimes there's no choice, so we have to go forward. And that's part of resilience, I guess.
I think it does. Before we talk about this at the national scale, let's maybe talk about it at the organizational scale. And I'll share with you one of my favorite stories of resilience, of organizational resilience. It's a story that I spent a great deal of time with my colleagues researching and reporting on from the field. And it is actually tied to Katrina, as you noted. When Katrina hit the Gulf Coast, most of our national attention was focused, for very understandable reasons, on New Orleans, which represented a breakdown, terrible breakdowns in governance and government response and coordination. It featured horrific scenes of death and destruction and suffering. And it was sort of cinematic, and that's where a lot of the people were, so that's where a lot of the cameras went. But of course, Katrina hit the whole Gulf Coast. And if you went up the Gulf Coast, you'd have seen many places where there were very similarly significant effects, but not as much attention paid. And in one of those is in Gulfport, Mississippi, and where there was an amazing organization called Hancock Bank. Hancock was a smaller regional financial player. It was, if you didn't live in the Deep South, in that part, and in the Gulf Coast, chances are you may not have come across Hancock in the past. But they're a Mississippi regional financial institution. And because the storm was coming, and we could see the storm coming, the bank took every appropriate precaution to back up all of its financial operations and to ensure continuity of operations by moving its data and all of its financial records to Chicago, which wasn't going to experience the storm in the same way. But on the ground where they actually operated, there was real devastation. Some 90 of the bank's then 100 or so branches were completely decimated. The headquarters of the bank was destroyed. There was no electricity. There was therefore no communications. This is not an era when we had long-lasting fixed line, mobile networks, connected to generators and the like. So you had people who were washed out of their homes, who didn't have ID, and no electricity and no way of getting things back to normal. And interestingly, the bank did something extraordinary in the response to Katrina. Because none of their customers could prove who they were, and the bank's own branches were destroyed. So what they did was they got some mobile forklifts, they went into their own damaged branches, and they pulled out the physical ATMs. They took the money out of the ATMs, and they used their own money, not their depositors' money, but they used the bank's own money, and they set up card tables in front of their banks. And there, they would loan $200 in cash to anyone, whether they were a customer of the bank or not, if they would merely sign a yellow sticky note that said they promised to pay it back. This is often without ID, because people didn't have IDs. Their important documents were often lost. And the bank gave out in the 30 days after Katrina, about $50 million in its own money in $200 increments to strangers, with no real traditional financial records other than these post-it notes to keep track of what they'd dispersed. And they engaged in an act of radical trust in their community. And they saw a loan repayment rate on those $200 microloans that was higher than their traditional consumer loan default rate. So they handed out money to strangers. They got more of it back than they normally did when there wasn't a hurricane that had decimated the whole society.
Yeah, some form of reciprocity maybe?
Right, so deep reciprocity. And net assets at the bank grew by $1.5 billion in the 90 days after Katrina, as people moved their money into the bank as a response to having that act of trust placed in them.
Yeah, I mean, and with a bank, trust is capital T. Right.
Mm-hmm. That's right.
Everything. Go ahead. Sorry.
That's right. So what's interesting about that? A couple things. are, there's some deep resilience lessons in there. One of them is that this particular approach and this strategy of jumpstarting the local economy with cash, with this kind of act of radical generosity and investment and trust, as you know, didn't come from the board of directors, and it didn't even come from the executive leadership of the bank. It came from the middle of the bank. It came from the branch manager level. They self-organized to do this. And the reason that they could do, so first of all, this is one very important thing about organizational resilience, is it's typically not a top-down or a bottom-up phenomena, but rather a kind of middle out. It comes from the middle of the organization where people have enough seniority to act. There's a sufficiently small enough a number of people where they can coordinate behaviors between them, but they're close enough to the ground to see what the need is.
Yeah, I wrote in just in your book, I took a note just for myself in the book saying, you know, empower field personnel, like, you know, empowering right. people further down the line. Yeah, go ahead, sir.
Yeah, that's right. And the reason that that's important, as you say, is in this case, they weren't empowering the field personnel per se. What they were doing is they empowered the people who empowered the field personnel. The people at the teller level of the bank couldn't have made this decision. The people at the executive level of the bank probably couldn't have made this decision, but people at the branch management level could. The other thing that's worth knowing is that just a few days before the bank had, before the storm hit, the bank had convened all of these folks and reviewed its core values. And in fact, they'd actually reviewed the core document that incorporated the bank. And nowhere in that document does it mention making a profit. It mentions enabling people to pursue their financial dreams and aspirations and to encourage the flow of commerce. But it doesn't actually have as a defined goal of the bank the creation of profit for the bank. And what was interesting was because they'd just gone through this exercise where they were looking at their core values, everybody was steeped in the mission. And mission orientation and resilience go very deeply together in a framework that you might think of as having very tight alignment on the values of the institution and permission to pursue a wide variety of tactics. So tight values and loose tactics in an environment of trust allows people to invent the behaviors using their best judgment to get the mission accomplished. And in many organizations today, because it's interesting to think about what makes organizations irresilient, we've gutted middle management. We've said, oh, that's inefficient. The only time we see middle managers is when we're making fun of them in Dilbert cartoons. Right. But we don't otherwise that's the place where we try to get a lot of automation going. Right. So we have organizations that have a hollowed out middle and where we've had a very strong focus on process, and process is great. Process is wonderful and process is profitable when conditions are stable, when circumstances are foreseeable. And so many processes that organizations use today work really well when the sun is shining, and as soon as it starts to rain, people don't know quite what to do because the processes are not as flexible as they need to be. So we've created circumstances, I think, for many enterprises that are highly optimized and therefore very efficient when times are good and break utterly and don't fail gracefully when things go wrong, as they inevitably do.
That's very interesting. You talk about cultural responses to adversity. Are social programs empowering or enslaving from the standpoint of being resilient in rolling up to the culture?
Let me see if I can go at this in an unusual way.
That was terrible. Difficult question. Sorry.
It's a good one, but it's not an easy one to answer in a word or two. So let me give you a quick take. So first of all, this is going to sound like an unusual place to start, but in general, the goal of most social programs is to backstop the ability of human beings to the regular, well-proven ability of human beings to make mistakes, or for accidents or for unforeseen events to occur. Insurance is a social program, for instance, and every form of it, health, life insurance and health insurance and, you know, property and casualty insurance is all based on the idea that sometimes we make mistakes and sometimes bad things happen and they're hard to foresee. In general, the benefit of having those kinds of safety nets under us is that they allow us to take better risks, to limit the downside of certain forms of risk and to encourage the upside. Now, sometimes that's a really good thing because if you happen to have a freak flood or a freak tornado that blows through your neighborhood, and you know, we've had serious weather and in the air, especially in the air of climate change, affect places where you don't normally expect it to occur. We've even had severe weather in places like Brooklyn, where I live. Having those kinds of backstop programs allows for stability, and human beings thrive in stable environments. On the other hand, sometimes social policies that limit the downside of risk encourage us to take bad risks, to poor risks. So if you have the ability to pay flood insurance premiums, people sometimes then live in environments and come to build homes in environments that are highly flood prone. And so in essence, you wouldn't build a house there, but for the fact that you can get insurance to cover the loss that comes from the fact that you're now living with increased risk. So what's true in this little small example is true broadly speaking. And so you really have to be careful about which example you're using, and you have to have a lot of information about it. So I don't think there's a general rule, but I do think there's another dimension here, and that is that we as a society, if you look at what drives resilience in communities and in fixed communities where people live in a place, or if you, like in a neighborhood, or if you look at communities defined much more broadly and less geographically, one of the central facets of resilience is rooted in trust and cooperation. Trust is by far the most important form of social cohesion and insurance that we have. After Superstorm Sandy hit New York City, where I live, there was a study done, commissioned by the Rockefeller Foundation, in which they looked at adjacent communities with the same socioeconomic conditions, the same level of damage. And what they found is that neighborhoods that looked exactly the same, that had the same level of damage, where neighbors reported trusting their neighbors, in those neighborhoods, people recovered much faster than they did in communities where people did not describe themselves as having a high degree of trust. And this echoes other findings. A wonderful piece of research was done in the 1990s. There was a huge heat wave in Chicago, and all kinds of people died as a consequence. And one of the things that was interesting, that a series of anthropologists went in, and they were trying to understand what separated the neighborhoods where lots of people died from the heat wave. And these were shut-ins and elderly people whose electricity went out and didn't have air conditioning, and they died from the heat exhaustion. So what separated the communities that had those tragedies from the ones that didn't experience the same severity of tragedy? And they did a really interesting experiment. What they did was they took a bunch of letters. These are like physical envelopes stamped with an address, a to and a from. And each of the envelopes contained a special piece of paper inside it with a code. But you wouldn't know that because the envelope was enclosed and licked, and you know, it was all sealed up. And they scattered these envelopes on the ground, on the sidewalk. And what they studied was the degree to which random strangers walking down the street in a particular neighborhood showed a propensity to reach over and pick up the envelope and put it in the mailbox, on the assumption that this was an errant letter that had somehow, you know, fallen out of the mailbox or hadn't gone all the way through it. They would leave them often by the mailboxes. And what they found was that communities where people picked up the envelope, didn't open it, but put it in the mail and mailed it, in this case, back to the researchers, suffered far fewer heat deaths, even though they had the same population of people who were elderly and at risk. And because the picking up the envelope and doing this very small civic act, which shows a kind of shared social solidarity with the place you live, was a really good proxy for whether or not you would take care of your neighbors. And as a consequence, you could see it show up in the mortality rates associated with the heat wave. And over and over again, we find that this kind of social solidarity, the connections that people have to each other, defines the level of success of communities and organizations and companies and families. It's in these small gestures of compassion and solidarity, where we say, I recognize myself in you, and we're part of the same body. The thing that's interesting here is we always want to therefore be designing policies and support programs that encourage a kind of mutualism, that encourage us to take care of each other. Mm. If that's the way human beings are wired, then we need policies and programs that encourage and elicit that behavior. Mm. They don't necessarily rely on it, because human beings are fallible and you need to have backstops to, right, to human generosity. But you don't want to design things that are isolating and that separate people, yeah, from each other.
So you're saying there may be a way to do it, to your point, aligning with how we would build resilience via our, yeah, social networks and helping one,
that's
another,
right,
and what have you. So I want to be mindful of the time here, but there's so much. It's so good, Andrew. Thank you so much. This is great. But so tell me how I can personally be more resilient.
So Larry, unfortunately, there's no simple checklist. There's no R's of resilience that you just do these, you know, what are these four things, these six things,
I
these
want
seven
the four
things.
R's.
Oh. Right, exactly. I would have, so did my publisher. they would love that, right? The reason is that what you find is that there aren't causes of resilience, but correlates of resilience. There are many factors that encourage us to be more or less resilient in the most general sense. So let me walk you through a list of about 10 of them really quickly. The first one is to have strong social networks and to cultivate strong social networks. Here, what I mean is not trying to be friends with everybody. What I mean is having some breadth of your social connectivity is extraordinarily valuable for the very reasons that we were talking about before, right? The more people you know, the more people you're meaningfully connected to, the more forms of support that you have access to, but also the more signals you can attend to.
So is Facebook making us stronger or weaker?
It's a really good question. So let me just address it, because the second part of that is to say that the number two on the list, following this sort of broad social networks of what we think of as moderate to weak ties. So you and I are now friendly. We've been talking for a while. If you call me on the phone, of course, I'm going to take your phone call and vice versa. We don't know each other that well, but we're collegial and friendly. And all other things being equal, we'll take a step out of our day to help each other now that we've connected in this way. But, we don't know each other that well. We're not close family. We're not intimate in that sense. And so the second part of that story is about having healthy and trusting close relationships. If you want, to a surprising degree, your personal psychosocial resilience is rooted in your ability to and the frequency with which you both receive and express feelings of deep love and intimacy with the people that matter most to you. And I'm not just talking here about sexual partners or something like that. I mean the bonds of, you know, the deep bonds between spouses, partners, parents and children, children and their parents for some of us, closest friends, that real sense of love. Mm-hmm. And love is profoundly encouraging of resilience. There are some others. Having access to resources helps. And by that, I don't just mean financial resources, but social resources and other forms of assets. Having a healthy body and especially a healthy brain matters a lot. There is a genetic component to psychosocial resilience, which we haven't had a chance to chat about in detail here, but there's some evidence that there's some both genetic and epigenetic dimensions to the way in which we experience adversity. Living in the warm zone of meaningful challenge, but not being overstressed, as we discussed earlier, and also holding a series of beliefs about the world is also correlated with resilience. And what I mean here is, if you walk around the world and you say, the world is a meaningful place, and I have agency within it, and my actions have consequences, and successes and failures are placed in my path to teach me things, you're much more likely to interpret the occasional negative events of life, that the rain showers that fall in all of our lives, as being random and chaotic and capricious. And your ability to synthesize them into meaning and relate them to your purpose is a significant part of your resilience, which is one of the reasons why people who have a personal cosmology, and I don't mean here being religious or not religious, what I mean is having a spiritual outlook on life and a kind of an ethos view, personal metaphysics, is correlated with resilience.
Are religious people more resilient?
Well, there's good evidence to suggest that at very large population scales, there's a small advantage in standardized tests of psychosocial resilience that people of faith demonstrate. But the best evidence is not that they are resilient because they believe in God, but rather because the kinds of things you have to believe about the world to believe in God also confer resilience upon you. So the challenge for most of us is there isn't a ton we can do about our access to resources. There's some things we can do about our healthy body. There's nothing we can do, most of us, about our genes. It's hard to control our experiences, and it's much harder than it looks to really shape your own belief system about the world. So there are some things that we can actively do to promote our resilience, and I'll just mention a couple of them. One of them is to put ourselves into a stream of continued exposure to novelty. There's a couple strategies for doing that. First of all, making taking an intentional approach to maintaining the widest diversity of people, not just being widely connected, but connected to a diverse network of people and thinkers and institutions and exposure to ideas, helps us continually reassess the default contexts and constructs of our thinking. And so, you know, one of the things that I do in my life as an example is once a year, I pick a conference in a random field I know absolutely nothing about. And I go just to listen to what's going on in that, you know, in that field, like go hang out with cardiac surgeons or tax accountants. And you'll discover, first of all, they'll be thrilled that anyone is paying attention, but it's particularly interesting because you don't have to go in with a presupposition that you know what's going on. You can be purely in the process of absorbing ideas and themes and patterns. And you often will find connectivity and kind of metaphorical connectivity with other spaces. But an environment of continuous learning is an essential element here. And the last one is focused on habits of mind. And this is a place where most of the work in resilience is currently occurring. And what we mean by habits of mind is cultivating mental habits and practices that shift and introduce a kind of intentionality in our emotional experience of the world around us. So we've been talking now for a little while, and I think you have a pretty good sense for the way my mind works, and I hope you think I'm a nice guy, but don't ever cut me off on the highway. Because if you do, you will discover why Italians invented opera and the vendetta. You know, we're like very passionate, very reactive people. And in that story, which you just laughed at, that little hypothetical two-sentence story, the reason you laughed is out of self-recognition, because most of us have an emotional life in which...
My wife is, she's studied positive psychology, and she is a consultant and everything to do with Zen and all these things. But boy, you get her behind the wheel of a car and you cut her off, man, you know.
Look out, right?
Yeah.
Now, in that story, which we all recognize, the thing that's interesting about that story is that it comports with the way we normally think emotions work, which is we're going along, we're living our life, somebody does something. It has an effect on us. It might be something they do to us. And our emotions are the reaction we have to that event. And so emotions are reactive, and they're part of our reaction. So things happen and we feel sad. Things happen and we feel angry and so forth. The interesting thing here is that people who work on understanding the active cultivation of mindsets, and this is work led by people like Richard Davidson, the University of Wisconsin, who's been studying the minds of actively meditating Buddhist monks who have an incredible ability to control their own mindset, to occupy intentionally emotional states and conceptual states to show control over their mind, where most of us are simply reacting with our mental states. And the view that emerges from that research is that instead of thinking about yourself, your emotions as reactive, imagine that you have a kind of pouch of emotiononium. And if you, with practice, can decide in a beat between the person cutting you off on the highway and your reaction to it, how much emotional energy you're going to invest in your reaction. Are you going to be very angry or are you going to be moderately irked, or are you going to let it go completely? Now, as long as you can be intentional, that intentionality ensures that your reserve of, in this case, emotiononium, never runs dry. And it's when people's emotional reserves are depleted that they do real damage, lasting and persistent stress damage to their
mind. So this is very interesting, because I was going to ask you, I didn't understand it in the book, because you said, but now you've just explained it, which is great. But in the book, you said emotion is not happening to us, but it's some kind of currency or bank account you can drain if not careful. I didn't understand. Now I understand. You're saying it's going to take some effort to deal with certain situations. Watch how you expend that effort emotionally.
That's right. That's right. And so what you're seeing now is variants of this approach used with humanitarian aid workers, emergency room physicians, journalists, active duty military personnel, children in the foster system, all of whom are exposed to primary and secondary, what we call vicarious trauma, but who can, with training, cultivate a sense of equanimity and intentionality about their emotional experience so that they don't do damage to themselves.
Well, so this is great, because equanimity is always kind of, so I meditate, or I try to, and you are suggesting meditation does help with resilience. But you're, I think you're saying it can help you kind of step back and maybe find that space between the stimulus and response. But what I'm finding helpful right now, I think others will too, is you've given now a motivation for doing that. In other words, when the natural desire or emotion floods you, these automatic thoughts, why would I pause? You know, why don't I just, you know, it feels good to yell, right? Or somebody cut me off. But right. now you've added something that I can apply. Let's say I've got a big business meeting coming up and it's going to be heated, or I know it's coming. You know, if I can keep that in mind to say, look, I've got an emotional, what did you call it? Some bank account of emotion that, I mean, you've read this, right? I don't know what I'm wearing, and it takes me 20 minutes to decide what to put on. I'm using up the bank account of, through all these little decisions throughout the day that I won't have reserved for later when I have to make the bigger decisions. Is it similar to that?
That's right.
Okay.
Yeah.
Okay.
Yeah. I think that's well said.
That's very helpful to me, because I, just conceptually say, okay, you know, I'm thinking in terms of units and bank accounts, that's helpful to say, okay, hang on a second. I need some reserve. And anytime I expend it, you know, or outburst or whatever it is, then I have less of that, whatever it is, equanimity, whatever, you know, the ability to deal with things later on. So choose the battle, right? Where am I?
That's right.
The timing of it. That's great.
That's
so
right.
Mindfulness, meditation. So do you meditate, Andrew? Are you a meditator?
Yeah.
Okay. Are you, what type of meditation do you do?
As befits someone who oversees a contemplative center with many different traditions represented, I'm fortunate enough to touch many of those traditions, but I practice aspects of Vipassana meditation and under tutelage. And also I have a strong centering prayer practice,
strong centering. Go ahead.
It's called the centering. It's called a centering prayer practice, but both of them, one of them comes from Buddhism. One of them comes from Christian background, but in terms of their origins.
What helps you balance, like books, people, processes, all of the things that you talked about? Are there things that you would recommend to others, whether they be tools, books, groups, that type of thing?
Well, first of all, there's no single recipe for resilience. People are going to find the central tenets of a resilient life are rooted in really good self-care, and in the experience of meaning. And so the ability to cultivate practices in which we care for ourselves and care for others, and a connection to really meaningful experiences, meaningful work. There was a wonderful study done recently of looking at early stage incomes, for instance, among workers in Silicon Valley. And it ranked all of the major companies from Google to Oracle to Apple, LinkedIn and Facebook and so on, by the amount of income that people made. It ranked them by the amount of stress that people experienced. And it ranked them. What was really interesting was that working at Tesla, it turns out, for Elon Musk was relatively low in terms of pay and off the charts, highest in the rankings in terms of stress, but also highest in perceived meaningfulness of the work. And, you know, the encounter with meaning, with purpose, is the deep encountering of community and connection are things that drive our resilience and our ability to absorb shocks and disruptions when they occur. They contribute the most. So for me, the answers look like, you know, both my contemplative practice, I'm a very passionate and avid photographer, and I have and I find great joy in contemplative practice, both in the camera and in the kitchen as a cook. So they're, you know, having those kinds of practices are enormously helpful. The answers won't be the same for everybody, but having an answer to those kinds of questions is the thing that drives us to all be resilient.
That's great. It's a lifestyle. It's not just one thing. It's a variety of things that connection, your personal practice with meditation, and the things that give you joy in life that you make a habit of doing that gives you overall meaning. That, Andrew, thank you so much. Is andrewzolli.com where we should send people to learn more about you, or, and you're on the various social platforms like Twitter and Facebook and all that, right? Okay, cool. Thank you very much, Andrew.
Thank you for a great interview.
Thank you very much. Bye-bye. Well, that's it. That's all the time we have today. If you like this episode, spread the word. Leave us a review on iTunes. Share it with your friends on your favorite social platforms across the interwebs. And I thank you very much. Big thank you again to Sam Williams, my audio guy. Make sure you visit LarryWeeks.com for all my content, and we will talk again soon.